morning, everybody. Happy birthday again, Walter. All right, so just a couple of announcements. This morning, day two of our 3-day birthday party. Day two of part one of our 3-part birthday party. Right, so today's format is very similar to yesterday. It's just a couple of differences. Tonight, we have a poster session, as you can see from all the posters that are standing around. Feel free to check them out during lunch. Let's see. After our last talk today at 4:15, we'll have a 1-minute lightning round where the poster presenters will have 1 minute and one slide to just give you a quick introduction and try to get everybody going to their posters. So that'll be pretty entertaining. Couple of just little tiny logistics tonight. Before I introduce our introductory speaker, Professor Ken Melville here at Scripps. So first of all, just a reminder to speakers who have come and have any travel questions or issues or receipts to drop off, please see Donna about that. She has all the information that you need. And then about dinner tonight, just a reminder, it's a very informal dinner. It'll start around 5:30. So we'll segue straight from posters into, you know, just a light informal dinner. So if you have guests, you know, spouses, etc., have them show up around 5:30, and that'll be dinner right out front here. And the other thing is I just wanted to introduce our two rapporteurs this morning. Sean Haney is a postdoc here at Scripps, and he'll be doing the morning session. And then Gunnar Vogt is a project scientist here at Scripps. I don't think he's here yet, but he'll be doing the afternoon session. So, and with that, Ken, are you all set? Okay, great. Well.
So, Walter, I've only known you 40 years, unlike some people in the room. So you were 59 when I first met you, and I must confess, I probably thought you were an old man at that time. you had a yoga mat in your office, I believe, and you used to enjoy your postprandial naps, and as I've grown older, I've discovered the wisdom of those afternoon naps. They're really one of the luxuries of life, but you realized it a lot sooner than I did. When I was asked to introduce the session today, I looked at the program and realized there was really nothing I could add to what was already in the program. And I realized that, you know, over the last 10 years, you and I have spent a lot of time talking about Cox and Monk. And that's not just Cox and Monk the people, but Cox and Monk, these two publications that will come up in a minute. And I was introduced to their significance back in 1995 at a meeting in Florence, in Italy, talking to Frank Herr, who had been the program manager for remote sensing at ONR and has subsequently become a much more important person at ONR. And he asked me, you know, did I know what the most cited paper was in ocean remote sensing? And I said no, and he said, well, it's Cox and Monk. And that seemed to come back to my memory when I was asked to do this introduction. And so I went back very recently, but back in 95, doing the search engines weren't as good as they are today. And I suspect in 95, I may not even have known how to figure out, you know, what was the most cited paper. I do now. This is what Web of Science says, that not just in remote sensing, but Walter's most cited paper is measurement of the roughness of the sea surface from photographs of the sun's glitter. That's number one. Number four is statistics of the sea surface derived from the sun's glitter. Both of those with Chip Cox. And together, you know, they make up a significant fraction of Walter's top 10. You might you might compare this list with the list that Mike Gregg put up yesterday, I think with the title, Why Are We Here? That almost seemed like a biblical question, but we'll restrict it to the ocean. So, you know, why has this been such a cited paper? And I'll get into that in a minute. Why were these papers so important and are so important? But Cox and Mann, actually, there are three papers. There's the two papers published in the regular literature, and then there's a bulletin of scripts that was published in 1956. And in 1951, I'm sure, you know, Walter, with his wily ways, talked the general into giving him a B-17 bomber for experiments that I believe were initially off the coast of Monterey. And having realized that the marine layer at Monterey was often not very conducive to doing airborne remote sensing, they moved the experiment to Hawaii. Now, can you imagine today telling your program manager that, you know, the experiment's not going well off Monterey, I'd really like to go to Hawaii? But they did. And I think they had about a month of flying in Hawaiian waters. So they added cameras to the bomb bay of a B-17 bomber, and I think you can see the door of the Bombay here. They had a yacht, supposedly for in situ wind speed measuring, but I assume it was also good during the cocktail hour. And they had this month in Hawaii in 1951. And the product of the papers was measuring the sea surface slope statistics versus wind speed. And the primary results sort of the results came from imagery like this of the sun litter, and the primary results were measuring the along wind mean square slope versus wind speed, the crosswind mean square slope versus wind speed, and adding the two of these to produce the overall mean square slope versus wind speed. They also did something else at the time. There are two curves here. One is for a clean surface or a natural surface. And they also wanted to redo the experiment that's described in Pliny the Elder's Natural History, dating back, to the early years after Christ. And also, I believe Benjamin Franklin in the 18th century went back and looked at the issue of oil and troubled waters. And so, Walter and Chip did their own experiment here, throwing out a recipe of oils that I doubt you would get permission to do today, including crankcase oil. Is that correct, Walter?
Yeah.
Yes. And showed that indeed this oil, which could spread out into a almost monomolecular layer, would in fact suppress the sea surface slopes. This remained the Cox and Mann papers, published in 1954, remained the absolute reference on this until 2006, when Briand and Henriot published a paper in JGR using spaceborne observations of ocean blimp reflectance and modeling of wave slope distribution. And in that paper, they said that the major conclusion of this work is that the Cox and Mann model of the surface slopes PDF, this is the Cox and Mann is the red line, the blue is their data. The Cox and Mann model of the surface slopes PDF developed more than half a century ago from a few airborne photographs of the sunbed allows an amazingly accurate fit of the distributions observed from space over all the oceans. The model fits the slope probability over two orders of magnitudes. In particular, the mean squared slopes, both upwind and crosswind, draw a near perfect aligned agreement between the CM modeling and the satellite data. And this is a comparison of the slopes between Chip and Walter's data in red and their data in blue. As you go to the higher moments, I should say here that Fox and Monk, I think, had about 29 cases or pieces of independent data over 9 days, whereas Brayon and Aurieux had almost 10 million data points. So, Walter, you've proven to be very efficient in your field research. The higher moments have some discrepancies, but really, this is the important, probably the most important curve. And why has this paper remained Walter's most cited work? I should say it's also Chip's most cited work. And it depends on one of the revolutions in one of the transformational technologies that was introduced into physical oceanography in the last 40 years. The first is satellite remote sensing, and that for oceanography, at least in the public domain, really started back in 1978 with the launch of CSAT. It had a massive tower failure after about 100 days, but it really introduced oceanographers to what could be done with this sort of technology. However, I recall a conversation with Stan Wilson, who was working for NASA at that time in the late 70s, and it was at a meeting here at Scripps, and he was telling me that he was having trouble convincing the core of the oceanographic community that these sorts of measurements meant much as far as oceanography was concerned. However, I also remember subsequently in 92, when Topex Poseidon, with the guidance of people who are in this room, was launched. And I think it was launched in late summer, is that correct, Carl? Oh. But I also think, if my memory is correct, that some of the first data was available at the AGU 4 meeting that year. And it really was transformational. I mean, it was the conversations that people had over the traditional beers at AGU meetings and in the bars around the conference center were really focused on the impact that the altimetry had had on oceanography. And it was also the time at which numerical models were starting to give results that looked like, were beginning to look like a real ocean. I mean, we know it's going to take 200 years until we can fully resolve the ocean, as you were told yesterday. But the beginnings of this were also coming along at that time. And it was the impact of this remote sensing on physical oceanography that gave enormous weight to the work of Cox and Monk, because essentially all of the electromagnetic scattering from the ocean surface that we depend on depends on calibrations that went back to Cox and Monk. And this really accounts for it. I should say that the other transformational technology in physical oceanography in the last 40 years has been the Argo program. And this idea of distributed network of profiling flows, initially just measuring CTD down to 2 kilometers, but now, you know, I'm talking to Russ Davis, I understand they've had a lot of successful tests with the new deep flows. I think the potential for Argo is enormous, especially being able to combine physical oceanography with biological oceanography and chemical oceanography. I think we haven't seen the full measure of the benefits of the Argo program until we see the integration. We see the integration of the main disciplines in oceanography. Well, as I said at the beginning, over the last 10 years, I spent a lot of time talking to Walter about Cox and Monk and the details of the ocean surface. And so this symposium is supposed to be looking to the future. So if you look at Walter's top 10 from the last decade and go through the things that might be associated with what I've just been talking about, there is his his review that I brought up earlier, the inconvenient sea truths, spread steepness and skewness of surface slopes, in which he made a comparison between the Copter Monk work and the work of Brennan and Oriot. And he's been doing a lot of work in the last decade with Bill Farrell. What do deep sea pressure fluctuations tell about short surface waves, booms and busts in the deep, surface gravity waves and their acoustic signatures, and last but not least, wind sea behind the cold front and deep ocean acoustics. So it's clear that over the last decade, Walter has come back to this problem, presumably because he still thinks it's important, and I know from our own conversations about this that I'm convinced that he does think it's important. So in that context, so I think there's a future in ocean surface research. I think the ocean surface is the outer boundary at which there are important fluxes, the overturning circulation for turbulent mixing down to depths of the order of a few hundred meters, and in ocean gravity wave generation. It's interesting that most of our understanding of these air sea fluxes is based on simple principles and empirical based modeling. For example, we still use the wind speed of 10 meters as if it's a fundamental variable, when it's obviously not. All electromagnetic ocean remote sensing depends on ocean slope and curvature statistics, for which there's Cox and Monk and Rion and Henriot. But there's no confirmed theory and little data extending into the important gravity capillary wave range. Walter's work with Bill Farrell in the last decade, clearly ocean surface processes are a primary source of ambient noise in the ocean, and this has implications for acoustical oceanography, and perhaps there'll be more about that in the August symposium on acoustics. And finally, both Walter and Chip returned to these ocean surface problems in the last decade. Problems that were so prominent in their early careers. And I'd be willing to bet on Chip and Walter's judgment in these matters. So thank you, Walter.
Next speaker has done a tremendous amount of work in the polar oceans and a lot of ice-ocean interactions, and today he's going to tell us a little bit more about something he's more recently delved into, which is internal waves. So please welcome Ola Johansson.
You saw that he was a skier, from these photos last or yesterday. And I remember in the Grenoble conference in 74, you know, he said, I need to buy a pair of skis, you know. I said, okay, I'll give you some advice because I happen to be a skier also. So we argued a lot about the height of the skis. So I convinced him that you should buy 210. And after a couple of years, he was really a little mad at me because, well, these skis were too long, so I had to give them to my daughter. I was fortunate to take part, you know, in this Greenland sea experiment. Fridtjof Nansen actually suggested in 1906 that deep water formed in the Greenland Sea. And at Walter's team, with Peter Rooster, etc., they could release the rain for a whole year. So this was the first really, this was done in the 88-89 period, for a whole year's period. And they really studied, you know, the evolution of these Greenland deep sea water for a whole year, particularly during winter time, when of course these connections occurred. And I was, you know, fortunate to be part of that team, and it was published in JTR. And here we have a section which I took myself with a research vessel. So you can see here, you know, this is the deep water formation. So, Walter inspired us to do some theoretical work about what is the future of acoustic thermometry in the Arctic Ocean. Klaus was part of that team, and also Peter Bottom was part of that team. And basically what we were doing, that we took the climate models from Klaus' group, used the Hope model, which was a 50 kilometer resolution model, and then we fed that into acoustic models. We were using the snapshot brightness, ray and RAM, you know, so they were different kind of acoustic models. And the whole idea was to see when this, if this global warming was continuing, what was happening in the Atlantic water, and what kind of effect could that have on acoustics. So, just an example, this is in the French Strait, this is tracked in the French Strait. Of course, Peter Michalewski and Arthur Bangor pioneered these and actually showed that it was possible to transmit all the way across the Arctic Ocean. And, this is always confusing. We took then the period from 1950 to 2050, and this is a control run, and this is the CO2 run, so to say, and you can see that it was a very strong warming going on average in the French Strait. And then if you look at the travel time, it turned out that all these 100 years, the travel time was reduced to 1.65 seconds, which was a very good signal. And for the Arctic, it was 4.6 seconds. So the point is that the acoustic thermometry should be a very good idea to really, you know, do in the future. But right now, so this was a white paper by a whole group. I mean, Harv was involved in that, and many others. And this was a kind of plan emerged that we should have an acoustic thermometry array in the Arctic Ocean, but so far we have only managed to get this in the French Strait. And this is a cooperation between the Nansen Center and Scripps and Rousseau. So there's a lot of technology coming up from that that part. So all this was inspired by Walter. We had a fjord safari in Sognefjord. That's the longest. That's the longest fjord in Norway. It's 200 kilometers long, 1,200 meters deep. So here we have a group of people enjoying, we call it the seminar, you know. So you've been married. And on the ferry home, Walter got very interested in some of the iceberg I was doing. And but Herr Hasselmann, I don't know if he's sleeping or dreaming. What do you think about? Exactly, that's what I thought. So anyway, so here we have two polybears. You know, actually that is outside our lecture room at the Nancy Center. And this was when we were 25 years, now we are 30 years. So the
symbolic thing,
Walter has a lot of polar bears from us, but he never got the white one. So this is one for you.
Oh, my God.
Oh, you do that afterwards. And I also think we should, since Walter is such a good shape, I think that we should thank Mary for taking so great care of him.
I'm the lucky one.
Okay, so now more over to a more serious topic. This is a brief historic review. You said that's something new we were going. That's only going to be a few new slides here. But anyway, what I really talk about, a little bit of the martial arts of the mesoscape processes, these different processes going on, and internal wave. And one paper we have published from 84, but I'm embarrassed that we haven't done anything with this. Is Meisheng's 87. So this is the first time I'm really showing the muscle from this 87. But I'm not an internal lay guy, so you have to be a little bit. Eyes. September 79 from the passive microwave. 6 degrees square kilometer, September 2012. It is super minimum, down to the half, and then again increasing in it. So there's of course a lot of natural variability here, that the things are really going down. And we published, Klaus is a partner in this paper, we were 14 authors. And the show you is that here we have the martial eyes on, and that's what we have now. And but in the future, when we were doing this, this was the Max Planck modeling model that they come, and you can see that when we have a doubling of the CO2, you get a drastic, really drastic reduction of the sea ice during the summer. So this was the kind of first paper doing this projection, and after that, all the rail paper came. We have recently published a paper in 2016 because there are a lot of uncertainty with this global climate model. And here you see three of them. This is Australian, this is the NCAR, this is the Max Planck, and this is the ICE, the red. You see they are, we picked out three of the best models of 25 or something like that, because if you look at many of the others, it's scattering all over the place. But still, you can see they show a lot of different. This is million square kilometers here, 2/4. So you know, it's really a lot of scatter. So that is a problem, and one really had to improve Klaus. No, I have done. I published a paper in 2008, very, very time simple minded, isolytically correlated the CO2 with the ice extent and from a very good correlation on an annual base. And this actually is for the summer month. So this is the summer sea ice extent versus the CO2, but here I put a little physics in because this is the way the long-wave radiation is getting fluxes back to the atmosphere. And then I asked, and then I got this very simple regression line, correlation is 0.92. And then I simply asked myself, let's not put the ice equal zero. What would then be the value of the CO2? And that is 500 ppm. So that is something like, now we are 400, 500, if it increased, if it continued to increase with 2, 3%, that's kind of 30 years. So this is, it's very simple, but it gives some idea. Now, waves, I know very little about waves, but it's an important process in the Martian ice zone. And this is a picture from our famous Edvard Munch. Have you heard about Edvard Munch, the painter? And that is called Bølger, which is waves in Norwegian. And you can imagine this is really the complexibility, that this is the breaking waves here, and then you have the trough here. So I thought this would be a good picture to show you. Now, in the Martian ice zone, Peter Bottoms has done fundamental pioneering work here. This is the SAR image, and here you can see this is the ice edge. And here you see, I hope you see, these are swells propagating into the ice. You see big ice blocks here. And actually, this was caused by a very strong storm. You have Svalbard over here, Greenland here, and the ice edge is here. And you can see the scale is 25 feet per second. So, but before the storm, you know, the ice edge was here, and not really any breakup. And as the storm came, you can see that the Martian ice hole is widening, and these swells penetrate all the way into 150 kilometers. So, this is a very important process, and also during this 2012, there was a big storm in the Beaufort Sea, which broke up the ice. So when you break up the ice, then you have that film melting, and it's very important, you know, for the position of the ice edge, etc. So that's an important. And you should talk to Peter because he knows all about this propagation business. Few words about polar ocean front. Svalbard is over here. Greenland is over here. And here you can see how complex. Blue is this is an IR remote sensing stuff. You can see how complex this polar front is. And here you have in this case a very loose ice edge, they're very moving. And you can also see that you have vortex pair here. This is really actually that was a lot of done by Konstantin Fedorov, and he called these mushrooms. And you can see one of these scale here is 50 kilometer. So this jet is shooting off the ice edge and go into a vortex pair. And this is a star image. And actually, during this my 687 experiment, we had two airplanes with the synthetic aperture radar, and they transmitted the data in real time down to the ship, so you could go and look for some of these pieces. Walter wrote the famous paper called The Spiral of the Seas, and from the satellite from Strelley Polar. You remember that Walter? And here you also see vortex pair, you know, and a very complicated structure. I'm not going to say very much about this, but that was the experiment or the plan, you know, to really try to find out more about this. Well, the ocean front is very, well, it's ocean fronts are ocean fronts. But the Greenland, you can see, is a very strong gradient here, close to the ice edge. And, you know, and also you can see some chimney-like structure here. And actually, the paper we have published, I was toggling a seesaw with a 10 centimeter horizontal resolution back and forth in a chimney. And we showed that the plume scale, I think we were the first to show it, the plume scale was something like 100 meters. and this also was theorized by Marshall and Schott in a paper. So it's a complicated area. Now, it is both Peter and myself, we published at the same time some of these ice age eddy. I mean, eddies we find all over the place. So what is particularly with these eddies? I'll come back to that. But interesting thing here is that actually Nansen was the first, Helen Hansen Nansen was the first to suggest vortexes, you know, in the Norwegian Sea. And I think maybe one of the first ones. But what you see here, what's interesting is that you have this eddy and you have a convergence. This is a photograph of the same eddy which we have sensed by SAR. And what you see here that you have conversion of ice. You know, when the wind is low, then ice are super poor particle places. So you can see that we have a conversion in the center, which means that you must have some audioscopic effects working here. And we investigate this one. This is based on three ships crossing back and forth. So this is just another. So you can see that these are really inexistent here. Now, what is particularly with the ice edge eddies that we were doing abrasion measurement in the eddy region and inside, that was done by Ed Schlossberger. And it turns out that in these eddies, the ice was making a kind of 0.25 to 0.5 meter per day compared to much, much less melting inside. And if you do a very quick calculation, it turns out that when you have eddies along the ice edge, it causes 1 to 2 kilometers per day of melting of the ice edge. And this is a very important process. It's not really in either regional operational model or parameterized in global models. Also, acoustic propagation is difficult. We published a paper on that. And actually, there are ambient hotspots. You know, when you have wind and swell, you know, it's the banging of the ice which causes the ambient moisture to increase. But when the wind dies down, and if you have eddies, then actually, due to the strong shear at the fringe of the eddy, they also become hotspots for the ambient moisture. So, very short, we looked at the 14 eddies during this mice experiment, that was the focus on the program. Typical scale, the 24 kilometer, rotation main is isochronic, 40 centimeters per second, lifetime 20 to 30 days, addiction 10 to 15 kilometers per day. And when the ice edge was present, the ice edge retreated 1 to 2 kilometers per day. So far, not included in reasonable climate models. Now, ice edge upgrading. Rupert Bergen and Professor Mork, they made a very simple analytical theory and indicated that upwelling may occur along the ice edge due to stronger stress over the ice because it's rougher. Actually, Stu stated that myself, we were supposed to do a sonic anemometer measurement, U prime in the Gulf of St. Lawrence, and work on the drag coefficient of 0.2 to 0.3, 10 to minus 3. So here you can see a section. This was a pretty direct cruise because it was done in December. But you can see that the wind was strong from east, more stress over the ice than over the ocean, Ekman divergence, and then you got that from 150 meters. But this was the first time, actually, functional science, this was the first time ice age upwelling was observed. And later, we have another case that was in 79, and the wind was going like that, strong wind up to the back. and if you use it per second, and you see that upwelling for some kind of 7 meters per day. So these upwellings, during winter time, it may be important for preconditioning some deep water formation or some convection. I think Dr. has really looked into that very carefully. Fennell, a colleague who has been traveling, is a theoretician at the institute to look at it from a theoretical point of view, so we've been doing a lot of describing the horizontal and stress profile in different terms, and so this was treated analytically and basically confirmed of observation. And of course, the RSS upwelling during summertime is important for blooming and fishery during the light season of the air, and then potentially for preconditioning of the deep water formation in the cold season. We saw during Pisces, we saw some, or before that, we saw some SAR images, actually flown by the CD90 with the JPL SAR. And we saw some strong internal waves along the ice edge, so we decided to put a small array here with two misters, 800 meter, 500 meter apart, with the polar. We observed our research vessel. And actually, Nansen already in 1902 suggested that internal waves existed in the Arctic Ocean. So the heavy drifting, you know, the tides, yeah, but also we were drifting from the deeper area up into the fish seamount or sea area called Vienna Plateau. And this is the Weisslander frequency. You see six cycles per hour here, and kind of two here. And this was the internal rate we observed. And what we only treated in this paper was this wave train, you know, starting here, you know, here. So, and by taking this time, we could then, you know, look at the, we also look at the frequency spectra, and as a matter of fact, and I think that has not been solved, that the frequency spectra for the internal wave for the Arctic Ocean is 1 to 2 order magnitude less than the Garratt-Lamont, and compared with the open ocean. And nobody, to my knowledge, has explained why it is so. So, in short, this wave train, analyzing this triangle, and actually, you know, the Doppler shift is small here because the wave is propagating in this direction perpendicular to the U, which is the V velocity. So we could then, we also looked at coherence, etc. But to make the story short, this is published in KTR. So we saw internal wave, the case study we took, 2 to 3 cycles per hour, and the wave length was 200 meter. We estimated the wave length and the phase velocity with the dispersion. And the generation mechanism is probably due to tidal oscillation over the seamount. But of course, in the Arctic, you had, at least before, you had these pressure ridges down to 40, 50 meters. So that could also be a generation mechanism, but not in this case. So I get into my final. So as I said, I'm a bit embarrassed that we haven't done really serious work with this observation data set from ISO 87. But also what was inspiring us to continue this internal wave experiment in ISO 87 was this SLAR or radar image. And the distance from here to here is 40 kilometers. I think you can interpret this in two ways. At least I do it. This is an eddy with very strong, this is backscatter. So this white is very, very strong backscatter. So I think you see a differential on eddy here. And you can then say, these waves, are they generated by these eddies? Or are the waves propagating into the eddies and being scattered? So we set out. So we put a simple array in this rather complicated ice age. And you can see there's some wind here, so the ice age is pretty sharp. But you see there is a tendency of something going on here, and actually the day after, this turned into a vortex there, and an anti-summit eddy. And here we have a little wind again, so the ice age sharpness immediately. But anyway, so we put on this triangle, and this triangle of a few kilometers side drifted by this eddy region. And this is a one-hour filter here, but what you see is that you have some strong activity in the internal waves here, and it's coming back again to this region. And here's the current measured from that platform. Again, we've got remark on that after that. But the current is pretty strong, you see 50 centimeters per second. So this is the period when it's drifted by the eddy, and then you have a quiet period, and then you got caught into a jet along the ice edge. Complicated. So this was the full resolution. The response of the thermistor for 1 minute, so we had 2 minutes happening. So you can see that you get strong activities when it passes the eddies, and then slower further up. This was further down in the jet, and again the spectra more or less the same as we saw from the first experiment we were doing. And this is really the only analysis we have done. And you can see that this was March 31, circle time. The wave, long waves arriving here, arriving 1 hour before. And B is the same, and C is the same. So, and this more low frequency waves has a period of something like 4 to 4.5 hours. They are non-dispersive, so the phase velocity is more or less the same as the root velocity. And here you can see that the array was drifting just by here. And we also took an oceanographical section. It really showed that it was an eddy. Here you can see the structure. This is 0 to 40 kilometers, so it's a strong eddy in that region. And if you then look at the root velocity, this is relative to the triangle. So the root velocity is kind of north here, and the current is V0, is in that direction. So that's the root velocity here. The reference to the ground is CG0. So if you see at that, it looks like that this is the group velocity as I just showed you, and it seems that it is coming from this eddy region. So actually this conference gave us a little kick in the back to really start working more with this data, and I think the important thing here can be done that it looks like that this eddy could be the source of the internal wave. And if that is true, because the ocean disturbances. So then we can maybe find important new source for that. So, recommendation. Climate models should be better. Waves are very important in breakup, not included in any climate model, not regional model, not even parameterized. Ice epiphones, very strong melting, not parameterized, not included. Wind-driven happening is important, but more work should be done. And we speculate, and I stress speculate, that an observed eddy may be the source of incoming waves. And my recommendation is that, I guess, the petition could set up an eddy and see how that could maybe probably caused by the horizontal shear, that this could generate an eddy, then generate an internal wave. So there's a lot of challenges here, and also some new experiment. And I will finish this talk with a good sentence from Fridtjof Nansen. Man wants to know, and when man no longer wants to know, he will not longer be a man. Thank you.
Description of all the processes that happen in the marginal life zone, and especially in your great conclusions that if you consider all the various phenomena like eddies, jets, internal waves, surface waves, that they have such a definitive impact on the state of the marginal life zone that they ought to be included in the models. And so just a couple of comments. One is that it's absolutely true that they're not, and the person who's done most, I think, to represent mesoscale processes in models is Wiesław Mazlowski here in Monterey, and his model happens, which includes as many of these processes as possible, is the one that comes closest to making predictions for ice extent that match up with observations. So that's a mold there. And also just to mention that the effect of that on ice edge advance was something that was studied in October, November of 2015 from the Sikuliak on an ONR project. And we were finding that wave interaction with the ice edge was really important for holding back the seasonal advance of the sea ice in the southern Beaufort Sea by breaking up new ice as it formed and then pushing it back. And as a result of that, the ice extent in 2015-2016 season was less than in any previous year because everything was slowed down by the wave-ice interaction at that critical time. So everything you said is really important and should be reflected in closer consideration of how to include those processes in models.
Carl, what do you think about this eddy generation as for internal waves?
It's interesting to be picked on.
the question of how internal waves and the mesoscale interact, or whether the mesoscale generates internal waves, dissipates internal waves, my guess would be the answer is yes. The question you asked me the other day, what was the observational evidence for this? I'm not aware of any. There is, as you know, a fair bit of theory. In fact, I think we're going to talk later today, at least the theoretical model. It's also probably true from what we know geography. course, this of course does raise a very difficult question. And if you fully understood Morgan Weissman, the turn away of mesoscale interaction, could you generalize for the rest of the work to react to some extent as just oceanographic observation of problems at the moment? Maybe somebody else here knows of observational tests of the internal way of mesoscale, sub-mesoscale interaction. I'm not aware of anything without the answer to the question.
There's clearly the trapping of internal waves due to the vorticity of the eddy. So near inertial waves will be trapped in an eddy. In terms of them generating waves and having to radiate out and other things.
Well, the inertial frequency is around the same as the M2 tidal length. I think that's 3 miles an hour. So that complicates. If you have a really strong push by the wind, then you can start to generate inertial waves also. But that's why I think, for example, that if one should do an experiment, one should do it in a place where you have very low tide, like the Mediterranean, for example, and at least you get rid of that factor, and then within the area where you know that you have lower abundance of eddies, and anchor the ray there, you know, and see what's happening, you know, for a long time. But I think it's an interesting, but I said I'm not an internal wave guy, you know, so you know more about that.
Of course, the problem is generic, any kind of wave motion. It's similar behavior for regions of generation and regions of intense dissipation, which suggests that one really needs to know the energy fluxes. To be able to pose some kind of regional energy budget before you can try to understand what's going on. So, for example, the trapping. Which is a kinematic phenomenon most wave types of any sort, focusing, defocusing, critical levels, all the things that we know about. So it really does suggest that some way has to be found to generate energy budgets for regions.
But I certainly think it is an answer. Something should be done there.
I think we've talked about this already.
I just wanted to pick up the suggestion that we should look at the interaction also of surface waves and internal waves and ice age and so forth. This is something that you've been making that point for several years, and we have a very active wave modeling group. It used to be the WAM group, is now called the WISE group, I think. It would be a good idea maybe if one should interact with that group and see that at the next meeting they have annual meetings. This whole subject is picked up because it's very often being mentioned, the interaction between surface waves and the whole ice edge and the internal wave regime. And I must have been too lazy to follow it up also, I must admit, but I think it's a very important subject. And if somebody from your group would appear in the WISE groups that have every year, normally about this time of the year, it would be very welcome.
Just a quick comment on observations that we made during the R&R marginal ice zone program that the RI just completed a year ago, is that what we found in the Canada Basin is quite different from the very heavily wave-driven mice that you were referring to in Franz Strait. And so we were studying in the area that's suffering this massive late summer ice retreat. And what we found, to our surprise, was that edge effects and wave effects were not very dominant, that we sort of observed a very large-scale thermodynamic noise that was driven by internal local 1D processes, namely the solar heating and all the positive feedbacks associated with near-surface trapping. And I have a poster that just touches on that this afternoon. But we were quite surprised how non-dominant edge effects were in that program, though very late in the season, just like they found in the following program, the following summer, late summer, wave effects are important sort of doing the cleanup. But the ice really had rotted out and become extremely thin before edge effects really came in and sort of swept it back. And that was really quite a surprise to us.
But what about these questions and that these spectra is one to order less than the Garrett-Hanrunk spectra for the ice-infested region? I mean, you saw, for example, on the SLAR image that, you know, the internal waves really move the ice back and forth. Is it the ice cover which is, or you know, the heating up that energy, so to say, is that the explanation? But there has not been any really paper on it, you know, explaining that the internal waves are less energetic.
Well, I mean, several papers going back quite some time have looked at that. Eric DeSaro and I have been made observations up there, Rob, I think, too. And I don't know whether there's definitive answers of why it's so low, but it is.
Yeah,
much,
I'm
much
asking why.
And it's a good question. My observation is that the inertial activity is still very strong and very dominant, the inertial motions, and the inertial winning after wind events is very dominant in transit of heat, particularly in the winter.
That's a few hours up there, right?
What's that? No, it's near if, so it's very close to into, as you said. So it's hard to distinguish. I'll tell you, internal waves are strong contributors to this.
Well, the other source that's weak up there, the tides, too. Tides aren't as strong. So you have the surface effect that you can't get the wind to blow over the sea, and the tides are weak. So I imagine one of those two are big contributors, I think, to that factor of 100.
One of the things that's really different, we think of the internal waves being generated by roughness under the ice and ice motion and differential ice motion, but near inertial waves can go down into the deep Arctic sea where the buoyancy frequency is actually less than F, and so they reflect and come back to the surface without ever interacting with the bottom. And when they hit the surface, they seem to dissipate in their interaction with the mixed layer and the ice, because as they come up, they don't fit the ice structure that they're.
So the turning point is above the bottom.
Yeah, and you would think if you imagined inertial waves being generated all over the Arctic Ocean, as you stood on the shoreline, you'd see the waves coming in from the open ocean, just as we see the swell coming in from the open ocean here. And it's not the case, and it's, I think, because the mean free path of an inertial wave is just a couple of surface reflections, and then it's pretty well dissipated. And, of course, all that will change when the ice goes away.
I was just going to say, it's not unrelated to that, but in the Arctic, the separation between F and N in general is small, so there's a relatively narrow bandwidth for, you know, I think, ways to operate. I think it's related to what you said, but that's true.
I'll just add one other comment. We've observed in other places in the Tyrrhenian Sea, in the Thermohammer staircases, where you have strong sulfur staircases off Barbados, that the internal waves are very much suppressed. And I think it's because of the strong convection on the thin ice layers.
anyway, you know, we may be very lucky because we caught this ISIS upbringing and we had hope that the wind was strong from east, and it was. And also we hope to do some observation close to an eddy in the MySix 87, and it happened. So we had some luck here. But Nancy always said you had to have some luck.
Maybe one more, and then let's wrap up.
So you were asking about observational evidence of internal waves being generated by balanced motions such as mesoscalities and fronts. So there's two examples that I can think of. Matthew Alford published a paper in 2013, subtropical front, you see this radiation of inertial waves from the front. And so that's one example. And also the guy made some observations in Kuroshio at a time when the winds were very weak and there was these strong inertial waves with shear out the front, and that could be another observation. But I have a question for you. The fronts that form the marginal ice zone, are they formed by the upwelling or do they exist already?
No, as we saw from Lord Svalbard, you know, if you have ice in the form the front of the edge, but the basic from threshold is really the polar water coming out with the stream and current and meeting the warm water, you know, from the salt, you know, and that creates that kind of stuff. Okay, thank you.
All right.